Hello everyone, this is a great Sunday afternoon. We just arrived at the Forest Lawn Cemetery to attend the celebration of my dear cousin, Meshack Taylor. As we all know, he passed away about a week ago. And the day is the day that he will be entering into the kingdom of heaven and meeting God. We are saying our farewells here today. As we look around here, you can see that this is a beautiful place that he's being laid to rest. I am on my way to the temple, which we'll show you when we get there, where we'll be having the services for him. You can see some of the different places and some of the view here at Forest Lawn. Large place. Many Hollywood stars was laid to rest here. This is one of the most populous cemeteries here in Los Angeles. Matter of fact, it's in Burbank, California, and it's right across the street from Warner Brothers Studio.
And when great souls die, after a period, peace blooms. Slowly and always irregularly, spaces fill with a kind of soothing electric vibration. Our senses restored, never to be the same, whisper to us. They existed. He existed. We can be and be better, for he existed.
And we are indeed better because Meshack existed. Not only did he exist, but he lived. And he taught us how to love while he lived. Amen.
Before I say a few words of my own, I want to read a letter from an email that I got last night from a dear friend of Meshack's, and he asked if I would read it for him. Meshack, you and I met exactly 50 years ago as incoming freshmen at Wilmington College in Wilmington, Ohio. On the pristine campus of a Quaker college, you and I were two of 25 black students in a population of 1,000. 15 of the black students were African-born and considered the remaining 10 not black, but Negroes. At the behest of theater professor James Marty Gilbert, you and I were going to revolutionize theater on campus by performing in the first black play in the history of the college, Lorraine Hansberry's A Raisin in the Sun. However, your father had a different perspective regarding how you would make your mark on American society, and almost as quickly as we met, you were gone. Your name then was Bruce Taylor. Years later, during the summers of love, our paths would once again converge, spreading groovy revolution as tribe members of Hair, the American love rock musical. By then, you had fomented your own personal revolution by changing your name to Meshach, indicating that, like your biblical namesake, you had come through the fiery furnace not only unscathed, but reinforced in your faith that you would be the author of your own story. We who are gathered today in body and spirit bear witness that your narrative, unique and celebrated, is not finished, merely evolving. Fierce artists such as yourself do not die. They simply go on tour. Enjoy your tour, Meshach, with a brother's love, Andre DeShields. Years. That's how long Meshach Taylor was a part of the lives of both my wife, Arlene, and myself. The year was 1970. Arlene and I had just gotten together a few months earlier as a couple after being cast in our first professional acting job, the play Hair, in Chicago, Illinois. During that year of 1970, a production of Hair was also due to open in Indianapolis, Indiana. And since their opening occurred on our show's day off, they bussed our entire cast down to Indiana for their opening. Playing the role of Hud in that production was the man we would go on to spend a lifetime with as Meshach Taylor. Of everyone in the cast, it was he we gravitated to after the performance, and I remember him introducing us to his new baby girl, Tam. We said our goodbyes and hoped to meet again. As fate would have it, within a year, both our productions closed. The national tour was started with actors from a variety of Hair companies. Arlene and I joined that company, and to our delight, Meshach was a member of it. We toured the country for a while. My father died early in 1971, and Arlene and I decided it was time to move on, so we left the show and moved back to Chicago. We told Meshach we hoped to see him again before too long. And it wasn't. That next year of 1972, the Hair tour ended, and I finished a production of Godspell, and the musical I had co-written was about to be produced in Chicago. In that musical was a part written for Meshach to play. We contacted him, he agreed to come to Chicago for the play, and he wound up staying for the next 5 years. During that time, both he and I and Arlene became members of the Organic Theater Company, and spent the remaining years in Chicago doing a myriad of new and exciting productions, some of which we were able to perform in some of the major capitals of Europe, including Meshach's award-winning performance of Jim and Huckleberry Finn among them. In 1977, Meshach headed west to California with a production of Sezwe Banzi Is Dead, along with his friend Lionel Smith. And now Los Angeles got a taste of the incredible acting talent that Meshach possessed. Arlene and I moved to Los Angeles that following year of 1978, and from then until now, we collectively, along with many of you people here today, created the tapestry of our life here in California. Those years, as the years prior, were filled with a multitude of memories. Meshach found success on film, television. He met Bianca, which begat Yasmin, Tariq, and Esme, and granddaughter Zara, and papa's boy, Dylan. Shaq became the godfather to my children, I to his. 2 years ago, I presented to the producers of my series, Criminal Minds, with an idea for an episode where I would discover that my commanding sergeant from Vietnam, a man who had saved my life, was now homeless on the streets of Los Angeles. My assistant Dan wrote a rough draft of a script, and the producers agreed to film the episode. My only requirement was that the only actor to be considered for the role of my sergeant had to be Meshach Taylor or no one. They agreed, and Meshach turned in a performance of a lifetime. It was only weeks after shooting that episode that he was diagnosed with his disease. For the next year, he fought that dreaded disease with a vigor and strength that was remarkable, so much so that when my series then asked me to direct an episode that following season, I again hit them with the idea that I would do it if they would agree to let me bring back Meshach's character, as we all knew that the chance to work again would be the best medicine anyone could offer him. In the throes of his chemotherapy, he once again turned in a performance of a lifetime. How blessed am I that I was able to watch his first performance as a professional actor in 1970 and then be able to direct and act beside him in his last. He was in my life 20 years longer than I knew my own father. I would have to stand here for days on end to recount all the memories. The times we all lived in the same building in Chicago and had our morning salons, with all of us contributing whatever dishes we could, including the fried chicken I learned how to make from his mother, Hertha. Or meeting his grandmother, Minnie, when she came to visit from Boston, who was then in her 90s and she lived to be 114 years old. The special events, the holidays. This past April, B and the kids called us and asked if we would throw him a birthday party, as it was becoming clear that there may not be others. Arlene went into her full party mode, and those of you who were present for it will recount it was a birthday to remember. There were his favorite Jamaican foods. People flew in from all over the country. The Coakley Brothers band played reggae on the stage in our backyard. And in the midst of all this, Meshach walked on the stage and with tears in his eyes, thanked each and everyone present for making this birthday. And these were his own words: the happiest day of my life. 44 years of memories. One thing that came to my mind these past few days was a time when Shaq and I were joking with each other, and he asked me, what did I think was the thinnest book in the world? I thought for a minute, and I answered, Italian Americans who ever were or who would ever be president of the United States. Meshach smiled and gave me his answer, and it was, notable Negroes in the yachting world. Now, I remember that. I remember that at this moment because I would have a different response today for the world's thinnest book. It would be titled, People Who Have Met Meshach Taylor and Did Not Instantly Fall in Love with Him. That book would win because it would have no pages. As that 50s song said, to know him is to love him. He was like the Pied Piper. Men, women, children, animals, one and all, they would flock around him because he exuded joy, because he was the world's best storyteller, and he would always make you feel you were the only person in the world he was talking to. And if you know his children, you know he was the best father anyone could have ever had. I remember once I was explaining to someone I had just met who Meshach was, and they said, oh yes, I know who he is. He's that wonderful black actor. And I remember I had to stop myself from correcting him because I realized at that moment, I never thought of Meshach as having a color. His list of friends was like the roll call at the UN. He was a proud black man, yes, but the color doesn't exist that could define who he was. And in a world of black and white and brown and yellow and red, isn't that the essence of how mankind should be defined? He was the son of educators, the grandson of college graduates, the great-grandson of a man who was the child of a slave and a slave owner, and the great-great-grandson of a man who was on the last slave ship that arrived in this country. His 100-year-old mother, Hertha, told me that information just a few days ago. The same 100-year-old mother who sat by his side with his wife and children and rested her hand on his head and sang to him as he took his last breath. No one chooses to pass with their mother at their side. But is there not something spiritual about being surrounded by your family and having their hands, as well as the woman who gave you life, pass you off to eternity? As I said, it would take days to recount it all, and so many of you have your own special memories that will live with you forever as well. But let me leave you with this. Because in this moment of sorrow and reflection, of sadness and mourning, I did find a ray of sunshine and hope and maybe even joy that I want to share with you. When my family and I visited Meshach Thursday past, we knew the end was near. We said our goodbyes and then on Friday took off to a house we rented on the California coastline to spend a week to refresh, repair, and await the inevitable. On Saturday night, we got the call. The great one had passed. Early last Sunday morning, I sat out by myself on our deck overlooking the Pacific. It was a typical June gloom day with a heavy overcast and a cool breeze coming over the ocean. And it made me reflect on another time, another day, just like this one. Over 40 years ago, when my father passed, I visited his gravesite to say one last personal goodbye after they had installed his headstone. Now, anyone that knows me well knows I'm not the most religious person in Dodge. But I do like to think I'm spiritual. I really do believe in someone. Something is behind all of this. I'm just not sure what his or her name is. So I did something that day at my father's graveside that I had never done before. I lay flat on it like a bed. And with my eyes closed, I'd said something to the effect of, "Dad, I don't know if you or your soul or your life force or whatever can hear me, but if you can, just send me a sign and I'll know that you're with me and at peace." Within a few moments, an intense heat radiated on my face and a red glow showed through my eyelids. I almost levitated from the shock of that moment, but with my heart racing, I opened my eyes and realized that at that very moment, that totally gray and overcast day had decided to open up for a moment and shine this blinding ray of light upon me. Without question, I felt I had my sign. Now here I was, on a deck overlooking the Pacific, on the same kind of day. And I did what I had only done once before, over 40 years prior. I looked to the sea and sky and I said, "Shaq, if you can hear me, just send me a sign and I'll know you're with me and at peace." I waited. The clouds did not part. The sun did not shine. But I did feel the message had been sent. Later that day, two dear friends came to visit, and sure enough, the June gloom dissipated, and it turned out to be a picture-perfect day at the seaside, blue skies, sun, and surf. Arlene and I and our friends took a moment to stand on the deck and look out at this incredible vista when we all noticed something bobbing in the water. We had seen dolphins earlier in the week, so we thought, well, it might be them. No, it was just a solitary figure that never moved below the surface. Then we thought maybe it was a sea lion, because we had also seen one of them earlier in the week following the surfers, but there was not a surfer nor a soul in sight. It continued its journey from God knows where and slowly but surely made its way closer and closer to the shore right in front of us. Each wave brought it a little closer until finally it became apparent that it was heading toward this little rock covered with moss that Arlene had declared earlier was her favorite thing on the beach below us, as it was such a beautiful and unique formation. And of course, since my wife leaves no mystery unexplored, she hurried down the stairs to the beach to retrieve the object, which was indeed intent on coming ashore to that rock. We all smiled and even took pictures of her wading into the shallow surf to retrieve the object that chose that moment in time, that place on the largest body of water on the planet, to arrive at that precise moment that we would be there to see it and retrieve it. The beach and the horizon were empty. We know not from where it came. And this is what she pulled out from the water. Happy birthday. The happiest day of my life. I had gotten my sign. Now we've all gotten our sign. He lives around us. He lives within us. I loved him like a brother in every sense of the word, because one should love their brother unconditionally and completely. Rest well, my brother, until we meet again.
For example, you know, my father, he wasn't the athlete of the century. he wasn't Bo Jackson, you know. But he could appreciate athletics and sports, and that's what I was into. And I came to find out from my uncle the other day that growing up, he wasn't into sports at all. But you wouldn't have been able to tell me that growing up. Once he knew that I liked basketball and things of that nature, not only to get me a basketball hoop, he sat there and watched these games with me, you know, and he became a basketball fan, and we became a sports household, you know. It's one of the many things my dad's done for me, looking back on it, and just seeing the kind of response that my dad, or the kind of influence my dad has had on these people. It's amazing. But I'll tell you, there's no better perspective than to be able to look up to that man, you know. And my dad was the biggest man in the world. He was. So in terms of these acknowledgments, the family of Meshack Taylor would like to express our sincere appreciation and gratitude for all of the prayers, posted memories, understanding, and acts of kindness we have received during our time of joy and sorrow. The family of Meshack Taylor offers a special heartfelt expression of gratitude and love to the godparents of our children, Tamar, Yasmin, Esme, Alana, and myself, for their 40-plus year relationship as our sister and brother. Thank you, Arlene and Joe. Thank you also for sharing Mia and Gia with us. We shared so many holy days together. Thank you. I'd also like to share a letter from President Bill Clinton. As you saw the pictures he's had up there with him. Let me get this ready. Excuse me. All right. Dear Bianca, Tamar, Yasmin, Esme, Alana, and Tariq, I was saddened to hear that Meshack passed away, and I extend my heartfelt condolences to you and your loved ones. Meshack will long be remembered for his big talent and even bigger heart, both on screen and off. I will always be grateful for the kindness and support he showed Hillary and me, and how much fun we had in our campaigns. I'll never forget Meshack and Hillary dancing at the Arkansas inaugural ball. He excelled on stage, in movies, and television. For me, of course, he'll always be the man in Designing Women. Hillary and I join all of you in celebrating his wonderful life and homegoing. Our prayers are with you. Sincerely, President Bill Clinton. Thank you.
Fine, intelligent young man. Who happens to have three beautiful sisters.
Have to say just what I was feeling, sir. Cause my sun doesn't shine without you. This is more for me than for you. Sir, I finally see there's no substitute for what we had.
Hi, I'm Delta Burke. And I had the honor of working with Meshack Taylor on Designing Women. He came on for just one guest episode, and he was so brilliant, he stayed for 7 years. He was there longer than I was. I want to say that I never had such a great acting partner. It was sort of like you were cops, you know? You had each other's back. Meshack always had my back, on stage and off stage. During Designing Women, I went through a very bad time and suffered great depression and had very debilitating panic attacks, which was very humiliating and frightening to me and confusing to everyone involved. But Meshack, when it would hit me and I would start to fall, he would catch me and he would take me back to my room and he would comfort me. Meshack was there for me in a way that no one else has ever been there for me, aside from my husband. He was my best friend, but that Meshack was everyone's best friend. Yes. He was more than that, he was a brother to me. And I just want to tell Meshack that I love him. And he was the finest man who ever lived on this earth. And now that he's passed from this world, and I miss that I'll never hear his voice again or see his face. But I know that he's up there and he will always be with all of us. And I thank you, Bianca, for bringing me into your family. You have the most wonderful, loving family that Meshack, of course, would have. Such a great family. Thank you, and all my prayers are with you.
I ask right now that you will keep us, preserve us, and as you have received Meshack's spirit back unto you, we say thank you, we say thank you, and we say thank you. Now, in the mighty name of Jesus to Christ, we pray and we count every wish done that will glorify God and advance his kingdom. In the name of Jesus. Amen. We will ask now that the funeral directors would come. The family will go out immediately following them. If you would come in processional out with us, we're going to be releasing the doves. And the dove is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And Meshack's spirit has gone back to the Lord. And so he left the frame, but he didn't need that anymore because he has a brand new body that disease cannot harm. Because there's no disease in heaven. Amen? So if you would be so kind as to let the immediate family come out. I know, Joe, that they want you and Arlene and the children to join them as they go out so that we can release the doves as we bid farewell. Amen?
She made my announcement, so we're good. Please give the family an opportunity to go to the front forecourt in front of the church afterwards. You may follow behind them and form a half moon behind them.
This is a look at the church. It reminds me of Woodlawn Baptist Church in Brownsville, Tennessee.
All hear the music. Script, I really, really liked the role because it's hilariously funny. But I was a little iffy on the character because I said, now, if I do it really well, I may never do anything else again.
Yeah, you'd be typecast.
Yeah, exactly. But when I went to audition, I saw Mario Van Peebles, I saw all the Wayans boys there, and a couple of other really high-profile actors.
Yes.
So I said, I'm giving Hollywood Montrose
yes.
every bit of flame that I have learned.
Yes. And you gave it. And they gave it back.
And they did. And it was a fantastic thing for me. And I actually won awards from GLAAD.
Yes.
For having a good image for a character like that.
Yes.
So it was. It turned out to be. Yeah.
Big for a woman.
Hey, don't say that, Johnny, because you're going to make me self-conscious.
You're not going to go getting that silly nervous laugh of yours again, are you?
Well, I certainly hope not. Man. She's right. This just ain't going to work. It's hopeless.
$2,000. Now, let's hear your name again.
My name is Consuela Valverde.
Is he great or what?
Have you been resident at least 4 years?
Oh, si, cuatro años.
Yes. I can prove it, too. I have all the paycheck stubs. Of course, sometimes I paid her with old clothes, but I'm sure that counts, too.
I am sorry, my teeth are enormous.
I'm Jonathan Switcher. Hollywood.
Hollywood Montrose.
Doesn't it just sing? Oh, it's...